The topic of this forum is really a very important phenomenon that represented these days. And we believe that this information is considered, especially with the role of technology and social media, is one of the main cyber threats for international and international security, because it's meant to be purposely to affect the public opinion with intention to change this and to shape the public opinion toward a certain policy. And we have witnessed this in Qatar. The basis of the entire crisis was based on a cyber attack that purposely was done for disinformation, for creating a smokescreen behind all these aggressive policies against Qatar. And then the entire crisis being built up from there. When they started this with using the smear campaign before the blockade, and then throughout the process and post their declaration for the blockade. We believe it's very important that the international community address this issue, because until now, you cannot hold the people who are handling those disinformation campaigns accountable for the crimes they have committed. These crimes of disinformation can affect the lives of people. In fact, it can ignite wars as well. So it's very important now, when if we recall His Highness the Emir's speech in the General Assembly last year, he was calling for an international agreement about the cybersecurity that address this touching issue for cyber threats. So whether it's a state or a non-state actor, they need to be held accountable for the crime they have committed. In Qatar, we have built our capacity to face any disinformation campaign, but with the emerging technologies, you cannot keep up with this. So we need, I think, to identify a global platform in order to make sure that the people who are either in charge of the media or even the normal people who have now the access to the social media will practice their job in a more responsible manner, that they will know that they will be held accountable if there is anything going to be as a consequences for the countries or for the people.
How do you distinguish, when you talk about state actors and non-state actors, how do you distinguish between disinformation, or this term that has been used these days of fake news, versus propaganda, versus the kind of messages that you as a government want to get out? Because there are some people for whom that is a continuum, right? Government information, media, news that is less accurate, and then absolute disinformation that is meant to either change, in the case of the United States, maybe change voters' minds or influence them, or in the case of this region of the world, as you said, possibly start a war. There's a range. How do you think about it?
Well, I believe that if you look across the spectrum, all of it can be defined as a disinformation, as long as this information is not accurate. And as long as you don't have people who are practicing their job in a more responsible manner, whether it's a government or non-government, even for some governments who are using this tool as a weapon just to create, you know, a smokescreen for their own population, and they just wanted to intentionally influence opinion about what's going on there. So I believe that propaganda, fake news, whatever you call it, it's all the same, but just with the changing of the terms. It's all meant to be that you spread information that's false information, just you want to change the environment or to impose a policy and to convince the people with this policy. Government messaging need to be a responsible messaging for the people, need to be transparent. And this has to be done through a very transparent process, that even if the government is participating in a disinformation against their own population, they need to be held accountable for what they have committed.
So in this country, you have an interesting situation, because you have a robust media organization in Al Jazeera, which has over time attempted to hold your government accountable for things. And sometimes that has gotten them into trouble. Sometimes they have gotten into trouble with other governments who accuse them of spreading disinformation. So how do you think about Qatar in relation to Al Jazeera, in relation to accuracy and reliability in news?
Well, it's very simple. In fact, when Qatar started Al Jazeera in 97, there was no any pan-Arab media network that covered the entire Arab region that is independent. We used to have BBC Arabic, and it was closed down before that period. And then there was a gap in the Arab media. There were only government-sponsored TV networks, which only delivering the news which the government wants to deliver to its own people. And in Qatar, we are a strong believer that the people, the Arab people, they deserve to see the right information. So that's when we sponsored the establishment of Al Jazeera. And we meant to distance ourselves from this network. And by distancing ourselves as a government, not to influence Al Jazeera, that was the only way to create this popularity for this network. Because if you will look across the board in the Arab region, even with the new pan-Arab networks that started later after Al Jazeera, they still don't have the same level of credibility that Al Jazeera has. Maybe Al Jazeera is a lot demonized by other governments because they don't like what they hear from them. But if you will check among the population, the Arab population, most of them are watching Al Jazeera. And we know that there is a price for this you need to pay as a government. Whether when you get sometimes criticism from Al Jazeera, or you get criticism from other governments because of Al Jazeera. But this is will happen one day for our region. If we wouldn't started in 1997, it might happen on a different way at later stage. And in Qatar, because we are believing that if we are going to be pioneer in this field, we will be able even to change our society to act more responsibly toward the freedom of expression and the freedom of speech. And I think this has yielded already now when we see, when we look at the media here in Qatar, we see a lot of independent journalists, Qatari journalists, they can talk about what's going on in Qatar and outside Qatar, and even they can criticize openly if they didn't like any act that the government conducted. And then they will not be prosecuted for what they have said. So this is also unique for Qatar when you compare it to the other countries in the region.
So you do have laws here about fake news, and one might wonder how that would affect an organization like Al Jazeera, which you have just articulated, something that the Sheikh has articulated, that you hope that it fosters freedom of speech and freedom of expression here, and that it moves society forward because it holds people accountable. But when you sponsor a news organization, there is always that danger that you said they won't get prosecuted for holding the government to account and being critical. But there's always a danger when you are the sponsor of the news that the sanction, the danger for holding a government to account isn't prosecution, it's the fact that you write the check. So how do you, is Al Jazeera a free network, free to criticize the Qatari administration?
Well, Ali, you are a journalist.
And a former Al Jazeera employee.
And former Al Jazeera. So let me just put it for you this way. If you have a network that you have built it over the years for almost more than two decades, and you have all this number of journalists are working for you from different nationalities. I don't know, I believe Al Jazeera, they have more than 100 nationalities. They are a United Nation in Qatar when you look at it. You as a government, you don't want to mess up with them. So the one who is working for Al Jazeera right now, and if he's doing his job professionally in a responsible manner, if the government will try to bribe him, if there is one will accept, there might be nine who are going to reject and who are going to create a big scandal for you. We are not a believer that you can pay what you want the people to say, but you have to listen to them. If they have an argument, either this criticism making sense for you as a government and this should drive you for change, or if this nonsense argument, you will have the opportunity to be represented there in the same platform and to express your opinion. No one is going to prevent you from that. But paying the check is not a measurement for any media network. If you will look in United Kingdom, in the US even, there is, I think they call it PBS. It's a government-sponsored network. Is it not independent? Everybody says it's independent. In UK, BBC World is a government-sponsored organization, and it is independent. So why people believe that countries in the third world cannot do something similar? We have done this, and we have been doing this now for 22 years, and proven that this can become successful.
So let me ask you, foreign ministers are by definition, and I mean this in the best way, your nation's biggest propagandists, because your job is to go out there and show people the best face of Qatar and a fantastic smile like that and be friendly and open. What are the things, when it comes to disinformation, that you are hoping to tell the world that most annoy you about the criticism of Qatar? What are the things that you think are misrepresented about this nation in the media, in social media, in disinformation or actual information?
If you will look at all the disinformation campaign against Qatar, it has been always trying to tie Qatar with a certain theme or with a certain group, which is not reflecting the reality. For example, when they are talking about Qatar relation with Muslim Brotherhood, with the financing terrorist organization, this became an annoying subject for all of us, because we put forward all the time what we have as a track record. We have proven to everybody that Qatar is a modern state and is not tying itself to what's been said about it. We have a track record across different crises that Qatar has a principled position among all these crises, whether it's between the people and their regimes, or whether it's among countries themselves. And we have been very consistent in our policy. What annoys us that most of the countries, when you especially when I go outside the region and the West, they are very much liking the story of tying any country with this new phenomena of terrorism or Islamism. And it became like, you know, the easiest way to accuse others. And in fact, if you will see some states, I won't name them, they just use it as the easiest way to demonize their enemy.
You know, if you can pretend that I'm not a journalist and there are no cameras here, and just like we're talking, name them.
No, I cannot. I'm sorry.
I tried.
We are in a very delicate situation, very delicate time. If you would look at their methods, it's very simple. Any country that goes against them, it means that it's a country that's sponsoring terror. Any person that's going against them, this person is considered as a terrorist. Whether if he's a human rights activist. In fact, there are a lot of Christians even, they've been called as a Muslim Brotherhood. There are people who are from different faiths, from different religions, and they've been called as a Muslim Brotherhood by those countries. This is cannot work forever like this. It's not sustainable for us. We have to be very clear that there is a mainstream by the government. There are acts, there are principles. All the journalists and the people who wants to research any country or any person, they have to look at across the board all of these things and not to focus just on the headlines of some news or articles sponsored by other countries or by other governments to create this perception.
So there is, you and your government have not denied your ties to or support of a couple of groups that have been other countries been determined to be terrorist groups. So tell me in your explanation then, to counter disinformation, what do you want to know about Qatar's support of, former support of Jabhat al-Nusra and the Muslim Brotherhood?
Well, first of all, there is no support for Jabhat al-Nusra or Muslim Brotherhood or any of those organizations, and we've been tired telling everyone what is the reality behind all these, all stories. Muslim Brotherhood, in fact, is a story that's been created after the Arab Spring because of some countries' fear that this Arab Spring is going to reach them one day. And they were claiming that Qatar is the supporter of Muslim Brotherhood, and Qatar has proven with a track record, if anyone is going to go and check and verify this track record, he will find that Qatar has been always consistent in its position. If I give you an example of Tunisia or Egypt, Qatar has continually supporting them, whether it's a Muslim Brotherhood ruling or it's non-Muslim Brotherhood ruling, it's from any other parties. For example, in Egypt, when the revolution happened, Qatar, most of its support happened through during the military council ruling time, which was right after the revolution and even before the election of Mohammed Morsi. Mohammed Morsi, when he was elected by the Egyptian people. He wasn't elected by Qataris, or he wasn't installed by Qatar or by any other country. And we shouldn't take away this credit from the Egyptian people that they went and they voted freely and no one influenced them. Does it mean if I don't like his methodology or I don't like the ideology of his group that I should stop supporting the Egyptian people? We don't see it that way. We see it now that he was the president of Egypt and we should continue our support as long as we are targeting Egypt as a country to be stable and to be supported. In Tunisia, we had a life example of a country which went through the Arab Spring, and after that they had an elected leadership from Muslim Brotherhood, then another elected leadership, not from the Muslim Brotherhood, from totally liberal party, and now they had their third election, and they have their new leader who is independent, who is not coming from any of the party. Does that mean that Qatar will stop supporting Tunisia? It's never happened throughout the last now 8 years almost. We have supported them when they have the Muslim Brotherhood, and we have supported them when they have the late President Sibsi, and we are going to continue to support them. In fact, Qatar is the second largest investor after France in Tunisia. And the same thing applied to all the other countries, Somalia, Libya, whoever. We support the legitimate governments as long as it's taking care of its people. The moment they start to confront their own population and they suppress them, then Qatar is going to rethink what should be the next step. But as long as they are supportive to their population, they are working genuinely toward a prosperity of their country, Qatar is willing to support anyone that chose by its own people. When you talk about Jabhat al-Nusra and other armed opposition group in Syria, It's unfair that accusing Qatar for supporting Jabhat al-Nusra, because Jabhat al-Nusra and the other armed opposition, they were marbled together and all the support has been done collectively. So in fact, if you will look at the case of Syria, we had established a joint operation room between several countries, more than 12 countries, that all the support's going to this operation room and it's been distributed among the armed opposition. In fact, part of this room is United States, France, United Kingdom, and the others. All of us, we have directed the support through those groups. We didn't go and pick. We have to support Jabhat al-Nusra through different channel. Jabhat al-Nusra, Qatar has zero ties with them, has no relation with them. But unfortunately, when especially the countries who sponsored the propaganda against Qatar and the disinformation campaign, they tried to identify all the bad actors in the region and to make them supportive for Qatar. But if there is anyone who is going to analyze this logically, you just look at the accusations. All of them are nonsense. If you will see that, first of all, they say to the Western media that Qatar supports Jabhat al-Nusra, supports Islamist groups, supports Muslim Brotherhood, supports Taliban, supports whatever, name the groups. Then they say Qatar is very supportive to Iran, Hezbollah, Hamas, and the other groups. In the case of Syria, Jabhat al-Nusra is fighting Hezbollah. How Qatar is supporting the both sides of the formula? We don't have money just to waste
on that. Let me take exception with that, because that has actually, to some degree, been some of Qatar's success, right? That you have been able to have relationships with people on opposite sides of conflicts, and in that way, been able to resolve some issues. So you were able to resolve some issues with Jabhat al-Nusra and hostages. You were able to contribute to the discussions in Lebanon because you have a seat at the table. You have been able to contribute to conversations between the United States and the Taliban because you enjoy some relations with the Taliban. So is it true that you have no relations with any of these people?
Well, if you look at all these agreements that's been brokered between the parties, Qatar has acted as a facilitator and as a mediator for a purpose between the two parties, and the two parties are giving the concessions to each other. Qatar was just a communicator between...
But you have to have developed trust with those parties.
You have to develop trust with those parties through a respectful conversation, that you are not going to undermine them throughout the process of the negotiation. You are not going to reveal the confidence of this negotiations. And that's the way how you build the trust. And Qatar is a small country. Everybody knows, all the parties knows, that we have no expansionist desire by having such a relation or having such an agreement. And that's why we became a trusted partner for all these, especially for all these countries like United States, France, Italy, all those countries whom we are supporting when it comes to humanitarian causes like prisoner release and others. And this has been, we have been doing this for a long time. In the case of Lebanon, they had a disagreement among all the political parties, which were legitimate parties who are members in the parliament, and we've been talking to them and we've been maintaining a very good relationship with all of them. This doesn't mean that we are financing or sponsoring any of those groups. And when I gave you the example of Syria, of Hezbollah and Jabhat al-Nusra, both of them are fighting in the battlefield. So if Qatar is directing the support to any of them, it will not be trusted by any of them. So I think it's very important to distinguish between the mediation and between our activities on those crises, which has been always very transparent through a collective mechanism. We never went ourselves to go to this group or that group to use them for our country interest. In fact, we have no interest except our interest is the stability of those countries. At the end of the day, we are a small nation. We are blessed with the natural resources. We want the prosperity for our people, but we want the prosperity for the other people of the region.
I want to get through a number of topics that you've touched, because you're so central to be in Doha today, where there is tension with Turkey and the Kurds and with Iran and with Saudi Arabia. You're kind of the center of the busiest part of the world right now. But I want to touch on a couple things. As soon as I leave from Doha, I will be going to Gaza on Thursday morning, where people there believe that you are responsible for helping Hamas. Many people think that that is a good thing. There are some within the Israeli government who think that Qatar's support of Hamas is keeping things calmer than they otherwise would have been. Your government has been on the record in saying that they are supportive of Hamas and the inhabitants of Gaza. Where do you stand on that issue? Because the United States has just issued part of the deal of the century that's supposed to solve all the problems there.
I have to clear first one of the misperception that you have just saying, that Qatar supports not going for Hamas as a movement in Gaza. Qatar supports is going to the people of Gaza. And in fact, you are going to go there by yourself and you will see the catastrophic situation that the people of Gaza are suffering from. And unfortunately, we didn't see a lot of countries who are stepping up to support those people. When you look at Gaza, it's like an open prison where the people are sieged and they are not able to have access to electricity, they're not able to have access to clean water, they're not able to have access to schools, some of them they don't have an access to medicine or to hospitals. And if Qatar and the other countries are not going to step up to support them, the group of the people who are in Gaza, you will find them one day as an explosive, which we don't want to happen. And we want to see Gaza as a prosper city in Palestine, and we want to see an agreement and a solution for this conflict. We shouldn't prevent our support to Gaza because Hamas is one of them, and there are a lot of people who are against Hamas. If this is going to be our judgment, then the people in Gaza will be dying from starvation. And our money and our funds in Gaza, it has been very clear. It's never going to building rocket facilities. It's never going to buy them weapons. It's going there and you see it on a physical project. You will see roads, you will see homes, you will see hospitals, you will see universities, you will see electricity, which is used to be 2 hours a day just a year and a half ago. And now it's cutting only for 2 hours and it's continuous for almost 22 hours throughout the day. And all this happening by the support of Qatar. And I'm sorry, the Israelis or the others, they don't like that Qatar supports Gaza. Can they deal with the situation if it will explode? And our funds is going through very transparent channels. How the Israelis, they are claiming that they are not...
Because it's fungible, right? It's fungible money. If you are paying for things that Hamas should be paying for, then they have an equal amount of money for other things.
No, actually, what we are doing in Gaza is either an assistant for the families directly, that our representative is going to deliver it and hand it over to them with the supervision of United Nations representative office over there. Or we are doing it in a physical project where you see the blocks and you see the physical projects existing and life in front of you. And it's not going for people who are claiming that they are building their facilities and financing their activities, which is undermining the security of Israel. Otherwise, how the Israelis are allowing these funds and these assistance to go into Gaza? We have been working with the Israelis, with the United Nations, to allow this assistance. Our assistance is not going coming by parachute from the sky or coming through Egypt, which is also blocking the support that's coming from Qatar to Gaza. It's all coming through the border with the Israeli territories. So I think this is just part of the propaganda which they wanted to be created against Qatar, because it's just serving the narrative of their purpose. And that's it. In Gaza, there is a catastrophic reality. All of us, we are watching every day. And Qatar stepped up to address this concern and doesn't want this situation to be exploded.
What is your relationship with Israel? Because you have had a better relationship with Israel historically than most of your neighbors, or than some of your neighbors around here. That has been adversely affected. And now for the last 2 years, we've been hearing from the United States that Jared Kushner was going to make the deal of the century, which was recently announced. There are some people who think it's not the deal of the century. So what do you think about what role you can play with Israel and what this deal looks like for peace between Israel? Well, there's no real deal, but what this proposal looks like.
Well, our relation with Israel has been very visible since I think it was a Madrid declaration, when there was a peace, and then we built on it after Oslo, this when we had this economic meeting and economic partnership here in Doha, and we established this relationship when we have seen a possibility of peace at that time. And when the war against Gaza started in 2008, and we have seen these vicious attacks, we have closed down and shut the communications lines with them at that time because of the war. And we have seen that the behavior is not toward a peace deal. It's toward more wars and more conflict. And we stood with the Palestinian people, and we are going to continue to stand with them. Since these wars in Gaza and all this support and help that Qatar is doing to Gaza, we kept the communication channels between us and Israel are exclusively for this matter. So we communicate with them for security purposes, for other things, only to serve the purpose of delivering this assistance and making sure that Gaza remains stable. And we have a stake in Gaza stability. With all what we have done, we don't want to see a conflict that diminishing everything we have done and we have achieved over there. Regarding the deal with the US, they told everybody now that they have a peace plan, and we were among the people who are trying to help and to see a fair and just plan for the Palestinian people. But any peace plan which will not have the recognition of a two-state solution, East Jerusalem as defined by 1967 border as a capital of the Palestinian people, and a clear destiny for the refugees and a right of returns for them, it won't be a comprehensive peace plan. And it won't be a practical even peace plan for the Palestinian people. We need to end the occupation and to recognize that we need to end the occupation if we want a real peace, a sustainable and just solution for everybody. But if this peace plan is going to be tailored just for the Israeli purposes, it won't be a practical plan and it won't have a future. If it will be tailored just for the Palestinians as well, with neglecting of the other claims of the Israelis, also it won't be sustainable. So any peace plan which is accepted by both or rejected by both, it means that it's a good plan that we can build on.
So you think the characterization of this as the deal of the century might be exaggerated?
Well, we hope it's become the deal of the century. We don't know yet what is the details of it. We hear a lot of information that's coming from normal people, not from the people who are in charge of the plan. But we cannot put our judgment unless we see the details of the plan. But we have been very clear with the U.S. that this is our position, and this is the only way we see that the peace plan can work. We need to start with a common ground. And I believe that the Arab Peace Initiative was a great achievement when it was announced by late King Abdullah in Lebanon. And this is a good starting point for everybody to start from. If they want to knowledge this plan and start from scratch, it should be something within the same framework and within the same basis of it.
Let's talk about the blockade. There were some people who were very concerned that within a very short amount of time after the blockade by your neighbors was imposed, that Qatar would suffer a great deal economically. Your GDP growth seems to be back on track. good things are happening here economically, but the two countries upon whom you relied the most closely to get you through this period of blockade and get food and shipping channels and all that are Iran and Turkey, both of which are in the sights of the United States today. Both are on the wrong side of the United States, and Qatar has had difficulties in this administration about being on the right side or the wrong side and trying to navigate that relationship. So let me start with Turkey. You have said that you believe in Turkey's rights to do what it needs to do to protect its internal security. There are many people who think that Turkey targeting the Kurds in northern Syria is not an internal security matter for Turkey. Tell me your thoughts.
Well, Ali, if you will look at the security concern of Turkey, they have been trying to solve this issue now for more than a year with the United States to create the safe zone to get the threat away from their border, and the threat represented in very simple groups, the YPG and PYD, which is part, a branch of the PKK, which is a declared terrorist organization in the US, in EU, in Turkey, everywhere. So for them to have such a concern right on their border, and they couldn't reach any solution with the US, they couldn't handle this threat until it's become explosive for them inside Turkey. When they see the leadership of the PKK is migrating to Syria and to be stationed there, and all the weapon support that's being given to the Syrian Democratic Forces for the anti-ISIS campaign is being stored and being trained to the people of the SDF, which PYD and YPG considered a big number of them. This is becoming an imminent threat for Turkey's security. We cannot go now and blame and put all the blames on Turkey because they want to clear this area. Because at the beginning, Turkey was saying, don't support this group, this is going to represent a danger for me. No one listened to that. And after that, we want to get away, to get those groups away from our borders. No deal has been achieved. And now when they started the operation, they have been participating shoulder to shoulder with the Free Syrian Army, the Syrian opposition themselves. And for them, they have one target, to eliminate the threat from this territory, and then to bring the Syrian people to police this territory for them, and they will leave. And they have proven track record in the western, the northwestern side of Syria, that they are not there with a desire to stay or with something that they want to claim these territories in the future. They have it. In fact, they have the places that's been liberated by Turkey is much better than any other places in the northern Syria part, and we have seen this conduct now for a year. We didn't see any ethnic cleansing like what people now and you hear in the news is happening to them. Almost 20% of the Turkish people are originally from the Kurdish ethnicity, and at the end of the day, they are Turkish. Even if people sometimes accusing Erdogan for being against the Kurds, most of the leadership of his party are from Kurdish ethnicity. We didn't see Turkey against the Kurds as a population. Turkey is against a specific group within the Kurdish people in Syria whom are targeting Turkey and Turkey security. And this is the mission which we believe that Turkey is aiming for.
So here's the trick. You have for years as a nation supported the aims of people who were not in power, who had goals of self-determination, including in Syria, including in Egypt. It's why some of your neighbors don't like what you've done. Why is it different with the Kurds who have a hope for self-determination?
We are not against the Kurds who have hope for self-determination, but this should come through a proper political process. It shouldn't come.
Which they've tried, as you know.
They tried as a referendum and they failed. They couldn't achieve it. We are first. There are priorities. We are with the people. We are with the right of self-determination, but also we are with the integrity and unity of the Arab countries, and we don't want to see them divided. We want their rights to be accomplished to them. Our aim is to build the nation of citizens, not to build the nations of ethnicities. We don't want to be divided based on our ethnicities or based on our religion or based on our sects in the region. We want to build a nation that each citizen is enjoying the same right as the others. Why in Turkey the Kurds are enjoying their rights as Turks? They are not having any distinction between them and the other ethnicities. So this is our aim for Syria. This is our aim for Iraq. Then after they get all their rights and they want to split, they cannot go and use violence and bomb people and bomb civilians and horrifying them in order to say that this is a right for self-determination. Self-determination should come through a civilized process that the people have to decide at the end of the day. And no one is going to hold them after that. No one is against the Kurds. The Kurds has been always part of the fabric of the Middle East. No one has said that we want to eliminate them or we want to just get rid of them in those countries. Most of them are our friends, our allies, and we've been working with them in Iraq, in Erbil. Barzani, he's very strong partner with most of us. He's very strong partner with Turkey as well. Why is that? Why Turkey is just going against this group? Then there is a justification, which is those groups are committing crimes and violence against Turkey, against Turkey's security. So I think we need to look at the entire cause. We shouldn't go and just cut away this, what happened, the last operation that been carried by Turkey as an isolated image, and just we judge Turkey based on this. We have to look at Turkey's position among all the Kurds.
I'm getting the rap signal, but I have two questions I want to ask you very quickly. One is, Iran was also very helpful to you. I've flown on Qatar a few times where we've had to fly through Iranian airspace to get places where you could otherwise used to be able to fly south. Iran is now again in the crosshairs of the United States. This is an instance where Qatar has relationships on both sides. Your relationship with the United States is a little bit strained. Your relationship with Iran has historically been strained, but they have been great allies to you in the last 2 years.
Well, Iran is our neighbor. Let us
first. So is Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, if you will look at the history, I won't say only in the last 40 years, but yeah, in the last maybe 150 years since Qatar has been founded and became as a country, we didn't see any hostility coming from Iran toward Qatar. And there is no hostility coming from Qatar toward Iran. We disagree on a lot of issues maybe in the region. We disagree on an approach, on a tactic. We don't like some of the activity. They don't like some of our activities, yes. But there is an understanding that we are neighbors. We have to coexist together. We have to live with each other. So we have kept this relationship, which is based on mutual respect for our interest and mutual respect for our differences. And this has been always a civilized and mature way of international relation. With Saudi is different story. Saudi is our neighbor. Saudi and the people, the Saudi population and the Qatari population, the Kuwaitis, everyone in the Gulf is coming from the same fabric. They are not different people. All of them, they are same people. They have, there's the special theme between the Gulf people. So this connection, the nature of this connection is different as well. But the conflict that we had with Saudi in the histories, if you will see, there have been a lot. And we have been, we had a lot of disagreements with them because we've been seen as a small country that we need to obey to whatever been said to us. And we don't like this way. There should be a respect between the countries. We respect Saudi as a big country, and they should respect us as a small country and respect our opinion. And this has been our way to conduct relationship with all other nations. In Iran, they stood up with the Qatari people when the blockade was declared. Their airspace, their ports, they give us all the facilities. Despite what we see from their behavior, they became an existential for Qatar, for Qatar existence, for Qatar survival in the blockade. And for us, we don't want to see this relationship and this need that we are needing each other as countries and as neighbor affecting our relationship also with other countries. We have forged very strong alliance with the United States, and it's not for a year or two. It's more than 45 years now. We have very strong relation, very strong defense relation, very strong security, economic, education across the spectrum of the relationship. And we have been always having a mutual trust between Qatar and the United States, and we are continuing on this path. Now, we see our friend and ally have a conflict with our neighbor, our role not to agitate and incite this conflict. Our role is to put down this conflict because it's not going to serve the interest of my ally nor the interest of my neighbor. Even my interest is going to be even destroyed. Not going to serve it. They are going to destroy my interest and even my place in the region. So our role should be constructive and positive to diffuse this tension and to put it down, to de-escalate it. And we maintain an open channel with the Iranian, with the US, trying to calm down things. We are not mediating among them, but we want to make sure that nothing happened between them that can affect and undermine our security.
Deputy Prime Minister and Foreign Minister, my only job was to keep us on time, and I failed. So I apologize to everybody here for starting your day off this way, but the conversation is crucially important, and I am inviting you to continue the conversation with us on NBC News because there are a few topics we haven't even touched on. So thank you for your time today. Thank you for helping us kick this off this morning. Thank you to all of you for being here, and I look forward to spending the next couple of days with you.